Kalismeras sas. Good evening, everyone. I'd like to begin by acknowledging the traditional owners of the land on which we meet today, and would like to pay my respects to elders past, present, and emerging. Welcome to another seminar brought to you by the Greek Community of Melbourne. Tonight's seminar will bring an end to this year's official seminar series. There will be seminar type events in November. For example, we have the annual economic update that's done in association with Delphi Bank. And we also hope to host the inaugural John Berger Memorial Lecture in November as well. Furthermore, next week we will be promoting a seminar by a PhD candidate at the University of La Trobe. There'll probably be a few more in November, December as well. So look out for those announcements. Thanks for supporting us during the course of the year. We sincerely hope that you've enjoyed the subject matter and that you've gained a great appreciation of the events of 1821, which was one of our was a major focus. Tonight's closing seminar is slightly different from the ones you've been used to. Greece is not just its people, its history, and its culture. It's also its habitat, its environment, and its landscape. And the disappearance of biodiversity should concern us all as global citizens. As climate change intensifies, so will the pressures on biodiversity of plant and animal species. In tonight's seminar, we'll be looking at endangered species, the Mediterranean monk seal. And in this respect, I must thank John Kotsiaris for not only being the sponsor of tonight's seminar, but bringing the issue to my attention. And just to remind you all, if you do have any questions at the end of the presentation, simply submit them through the chat or comments section on Facebook or YouTube. We do monitor them. Returning to tonight's seminar, the Mediterranean monk seal was formerly found throughout the Mediterranean Sea, the Black Sea, and the Northwest African coast. But its population has declined rapidly since the 1970s, most probably due to disturbance, human activities, degradation of habitat, pollution, hunting, and killing by fishermen who see them as pests, bycatch, plus lack of awareness. They have not been seen in the Black Sea since 1997, and the last sighting in Sardinia was in 2010. The Mediterranean monk seal, once abundant and widely distributed, is the rarest pinniped in the world today, with no more than 800 individuals globally. Greece hosts over 50% of its remaining population in the last stronghold of the species in the Mediterranean. Although most seals prefer cold climates and live in areas close to the poles, some seals have adapted to more temperate climates. The Mediterranean monk seal is one of the rarest seals on our planet. It's on the endangered list and threatened with extinction unless preservation and monitoring strategies are employed. Greece is shouldering a lot of these preservation efforts as the bulk of the known seal population resides in its territorial waters. In the Aegean Sea, Greece has allocated a large area for the preservation of the Mediterranean monk seal and its habitat. The Alonissos Marine Park, that extends around the northern Sporades Islands, is the main action ground for the Greek MOM organization, the Hellenic Society for the Study and the Protection of the Mediterranean monk seal. It is greatly involved in raising awareness and the general public and fundraising for the monk seal preservation cause. To tell us more about the Mediterranean monk seal, we have with us today Kimon Koemtzopoulos, marine biologist specializing in marine mammals, specifically the dolphins of Greece and the Mediterranean monk seal. For the past 5 years, Kimon has been working for MOM, a non-profit NGO established in 1988, active in marine conservation through the study and protection of this emblematic Mediterranean monk seal. Kimon, welcome. It's an honor to have you deliver this presentation. The podium is yours.
Thank you very much, Nick. It's a pleasure to be here. Καλησπέρα και από μένα, everyone. And I will start with my presentation now. Let's see. Okay. So, today I would like to talk to you about the Mediterranean monk seal, which is the rarest pinniped in the world. First, some things about the animal. The Mediterranean monk seal was first scientifically described by Jean Hermann in 1779, a French naturalist. It belongs to the class of mammalia. It's a mammal. It's a carnivore. It belongs to the clade of pinnipeds, which in all include 35 species, including fur seals, sea lions, true seals, and the walrus. And it belongs to the family of Phocidae, so true seals, which in total include 19 species. The genus and the species is Monachus monachus. A lot of people think that because Monachus means also alone or lonely in Greek, they think that the name was given because of its lonely lifestyle. That is not true. It was given by Jean Hermann because of the perceived resemblance to Capuchin monks. Here you see a very happy Mediterranean monk seal, a subadult, a male subadult, doing the banana. He's in a very nice, relaxed pose. So, the monk seal evolved around 20 million years ago, and what a few people realize is that seals, all marine mammals, in fact, seals and dolphins, whales, porpoises, they evolved from terrestrial mammals. Seals evolved from something that looked like something like what you see on your screen now, which was a terrestrial mammal using lakes or swamps, and which gradually started moving, started using the aquatic environment more and evolved to better use the aquatic environment more. So instead of legs, their legs evolved into flippers. They got a more hydrodynamic shape, better insulation, etc. Its closest relatives are the Hawaiian monk seal, Neomonachus auslandi, which of course lives in Hawaii. It's very similar in appearance to the Mediterranean monk seal, very similar in habits and behavior, and faces very similar problems that we will see today. And the Caribbean monk seal, Neomonachus tropicalis, which unfortunately went extinct in the 70s. So for me, one of the most interesting things about the monk seal is its history. In ancient Greece, it was described very accurately by Aristotle, and it was actually considered a sacred animal. It was protected by Apollo and Poseidon. And of course, you don't mess with Apollo and Poseidon. So the animal, it prospered 2,500 years ago. In fact, we have a lot of evidence of monk seals being depicted in culture, in coins. Here you see a monk seal on a coin. You see also dolphins on coins. You see a monk seal on an amphora, painted on an amphora, and it's observing a warrior fighting a sea monster. In fact, there has also been the skeleton of a monk seal found in a family grave, a big honor, which shows that this animal was beloved by this family and was buried alongside its owners, let's say, alongside this family as if it were a pet. In ancient Greece, the Mediterranean monk seal is described as living in large colonies and using open beaches, but also caves. This is also described in texts of in the epic poems of Homer, for example, it is mentioned, and also by Aristotle. And it's also described as a very curious animal approaching humans. However, this was not meant to last. During the Roman era, this all changed, and the animal started being very intensively hunted for its skin, fat. So today, this this intensive hunting has led to a very big shift in the monk seal distribution. Whereas historically, you can see here on the map that it was distributed throughout the Black Sea, throughout the coastline of the Mediterranean Sea, and along the northwestern coast of Africa in the Atlantic, including island complexes such as the Canary Island, the Azores, and Madeira. Today, the population of the Mediterranean monk seal is highly fragmented. Today, the monk seal exists in basically three subpopulations. One in the Western Sahara in Cabo Blanco, numbering around 250 to 300 animals that you can see here. One in Madeira, numbering around 25 to 35 animals, a tiny population. This population of 10 animals is thought to no longer exist because of a lack of study. It is still a question mark, but it is thought to no longer exist today. And the bulk of the population still survives around the Greek seas, the Ionian and the Aegean, along the coast of Turkey, and now in Cyprus, numbering around 450 to 500 animals today. However, other than the change in distribution of the monk seal, there has also been a massive change in its behavior. As I said earlier, the animal was described in ancient Greece as using open beaches to live and to breed, and living in large colonies. Today, because of the intensive hunting and the persecution of the animal, its behavior has changed. As you may imagine, animals living in large colonies on open beaches are an easy target, so their genes are the first to be removed from the genetic pool. Animals that use hidden marine caves, they are harder to hunt, so they are the ones that get to survive and breed. So today, first of all, the reason that this animal has managed to survive in Greece is exactly because of the country's very highly complex coastline, with 16,000 kilometers of coastline, a third of the total of the Mediterranean, and the geomorphology that allowed for the formation of marine caves with specific characteristics that monk seals like. So today the animal only, almost exclusively, uses marine caves to rest and to breed. These marine caves, they need to have a beach inside, a terrestrial component for the animals to go on land and rest. Additionally, however, its behavior towards humans has also changed, and where in ancient Greece it was described as a very curious animal approaching humans, today its behavior is exactly the opposite. The species has learned to avoid humans and to be very scared and shy. The good news, on the other hand, is that its conservation status, while being considered today as endangered by the International Union for the Conservation of Nature, this is actually an upgrade from being critically endangered until 2016. So this has been a very big success for the conservation of this species and for marine conservation in general in Greece and in the Mediterranean. Its population trend today is increasing. However, it still remains the rarest pinniped globally, the rarest marine mammal of Europe, with a population of no more than 800 individuals today. And still, conservation actions and management is required to ensure that new threats that arise are dealt with efficiently for this species to survive. And we will see more about what these threats are in a bit. So we talked about the global, let's say, so Mediterranean and Atlantic population of the monk seal. but let's focus specifically in Greece. In Greece, a lot of people don't realize this, but because they hear about the National Marine Park of Alonissos, specifically set out and founded for the protection of the seal. So a lot of Greeks that even live here, they don't realize that the species is found throughout the country, not only in one specific area. However, our research activities and the monitoring of populations locally and throughout the country, in addition and assisted by our National Rescue and Information Network, a network of volunteers that started in 1992, that has been steadily providing information on sightings of monk seals to MOM throughout the country over these decades, have helped us create a map of sightings of monk seals throughout the country, as well as to identify certain breeding nuclei. These breeding nuclei have to are connected to the existence of high quality marine caves in which seals can breed. So these are the National Marine Park of Alonissos, Northern Sporades, of course. I don't know if you can see my mouse here in this area, with an estimated 55 to 60 individuals. The complex of Kimolos and Poliegos down here, with an estimated 50 individuals. In Karpathos and Saria, an estimated 25 to 30 individuals. In Yaros, in the Northern Cyclades, the Northern Cyclades in general have a very nice population centered around Yaros Island here, of around 60 individuals. And of course, the Ionian Islands. I will not include Kythira in this, but the Ionian Islands here host around 30 to 35 individuals. So the morphology, external morphology of the seal is one quite familiar to us. It's it's one of the largest seals. It can reach 2.8 meters in length and can weigh over 300 kilograms, and it can live up to and even more than 30 years. Of course, it has flippers instead of legs. It has a gray, brown, or black back with short hair of 0.5 centimeters in length and a lighter, white or beige belly. It has 32 teeth. Its eyes have reflectors much like terrestrial nocturnal mammals. They can see very well in very low light situations, which of course is something very useful in the sea, where light attenuates very fast as you go deeper. Its whiskers additionally assist it with hunting by sensing vibrations. So they are they can use their whiskers to sense their environment. And throughout their life, they accumulate certain scars, either on their back or the rest of their body that we will see soon. There are some differences between a male and a female. This particular particular animal here is an adult female. So the life of a monk seal, throughout the life of monk seal, it changes its appearance. We'll start from the bottom. A newborn Mediterranean monk seal. When monk seals are born, they are born at around 1 meter in length, and they weigh around 15 to 18 kilograms. Of course, being marine mammals, they have to they have to be born quite ready to swim. So they are born quite large. A big investment is done there. And they are born with black or dark brown fur to keep them warm, of around 1.5 centimeters in length. These newborn pups, they have a very distinct white patch on the belly that is sexually dimorphic. It's different between males and females, and it's what we use to to know if a pup is male or female when we analyze photographs or visit caves. We'll get more into that in a bit. Females have a rounded patch towards the back flippers, whereas males have more of a butterfly shape. At around the age of 1.5 months, the pup starts molting. It starts shedding this baby fur. And by the age of 2 to 3 months, it has completely lost its fur and it now has the appearance of a juvenile seal with a classic look of the gray or brown back and whiter belly that we see in most photographs. At this stage, you cannot distinguish visually from afar between a male and a female. Having molted does not necessarily mean that it is independent of its mother. Mediterranean monk seals, of course, being Mediterranean, are dependent on their mother for a much longer time than most seals. Most seals will be dependent on their mother for a couple of weeks, maybe 3 weeks. A Mediterranean monk seal will be dependent on its mother for up to 4 months. During this time, it will nurse from its mother, and gradually it will start slowly hunting some fish and preparing for its life alone. And at some point, at around the age of 4 months, its mother will leave it and it will have to fend for itself. So at this stage, the juvenile will have gained a lot of weight. It will have reached around 60 kilos and its mother will leave it. In the beginning, it's a bit hard for them to start hunting on their own, but fortunately they have built enough fat reserve to burn over the next couple of weeks that it will start losing some weight until it gets used to hunting alone and their instinct kicks in and they are able to fend for themselves. These juveniles will retain this appearance until the age of 4 to 5 years. Females will become sexually mature. They will become adults at around the age of 4 years. They will remain with the same coloration that they had when they were juveniles. So a gray or silver or brown back with a whiter belly. But they will start accumulating certain scars, mainly on the back, which are acquired from mating. And this is how you distinguish an adult female that you might see in the water, from the scars that it has on its back. Males, on the other hand, will become adults, will become sexually mature at around the age of 5 to 6 years old, at which point they will revert back to their newborn coloration. They will become black again, and they will have a white patch on their belly. In fact, what is interesting is that we recently discovered is that the shape of this white patch will be the same as the shape of the white patch they had when they were newborn. Additionally, because they start fighting for territory, they will start accumulating scars, mainly around their neck and back flippers. So, reproduction of the monk seal. Monk seals mate in the water. The pregnancy lasts for 10 months. They always give birth to one pup. Now, a small parenthesis here. Not in the monks, in the Mediterranean monk seal, but in the Hawaiian monk seal, there has recently been an event of two pups that are most likely twins. It is not certain because the birth was not observed, and there's a small chance that they were just nursing from the same from one mother. But this was a very interesting thing to observe. Twins for the first time in the Hawaiian monk seal. In the Mediterranean monk seal, we have not seen this yet. So one pup at a time. They always give birth on land and almost exclusively in dark, sheltered marine caves with a beach inside. Most birds occur from August to December, with the maximum births occurring in October. It's not unheard of that monk seals might be born in other times of the year, but this is the main birthing period, August to December. As I said earlier, the nursing can last for up to 3 to 4 months, at which point the mother will leave the pup alone. And the species displays what is known as a medium polygyny, where you have a male or some males that control territory and breeding rights with females. Here you can see a particularly attractive monk seal. It is my belief, my scientific belief, that part of the reason for the increasing trend of the monk seal population is this look here that you can see, criminally attractive, as one would describe it. So the monk seal, being a marine mammal, of course, uses the marine habitat for most of its life. Significantly more time is allocated in the marine habitat, the marine component, and the terrestrial habitat, mainly foraging, looking for food. The species can dive to up to 200 meters in depth. It can dive more, but this is the deepest recorded dive that we have, up to 200 meters. And in reality, it will not need to go any further because up to 200 meters is where it finds its food. And it can dive for up to 20 minutes. It eats all kinds of fish, crustaceans, and mostly octopus. The favorite food of the monk seal is octopus. It can eat up to 8% of its weight per day, which for a 300 kilo animal is a significant amount. Its vision is very good in water, however it is blurry outside. It has very good hearing both in the water and outside, and it has a layer of fat known as blubber that acts as an insulator to help it cope with the cold waters. However, even though the species spends most of its life in the marine environment, the truly important and key habitat for the survival of the species is the terrestrial component of its habitat, namely marine caves with a beach inside. This is where they give birth and raise their young. So these secluded marine caves are a very valuable asset to monk seals. And the species, it's very particulate about the caves it uses. It requires certain specific characteristics that we now know today. We have researched extensively, and caves can be separated into levels of quality using these characteristics. So the larger the beach, the better. The softer the beach substrate, the better. So sand, better than pebbles, better than rocks. The distance from human populations is a characteristic also defining the quality of a marine cave. The length of the mouth of the cave, if there's a twist to protect from extreme conditions, even better. They want some light, but not too much. So you can see there's certain requirements that exclude more and more caves from what can be used by monk seals. Here in the photograph, you can see two females. One has its pup. It's nice and round, very well fed. Sitting, resting on a rock. These are some pups, photographs of pups that we have from caves, from visitations to caves. Excuse me. So I would like to talk to you a bit about the threats the monk seal faces and the reason why this species requires management and conservation actions. I will go through each of these individually. Of course, the largest threat to monk seals, and the reason why it is in the situation it is today, is intentional killing. This mostly occurs because of its interaction with coastal fishing, which causes large economic damage. Of course, the monk seal, being a very smart animal, very cunning, it has found easy ways to feed, which is, of course, to approach fishing vessels and to eat from nets or long lines. This, of course, doesn't make fishermen particularly happy, both because of the immediate loss, the direct loss of fish, of their catch, but also the indirect economic damage, which is also larger than the direct loss, of having to repair and to replace their nets being ripped. Intentional killing can reach, we have found that intentional killing reaches 50% of all deaths for adult animals for which we have done necropsies. And it still occurs today, but thankfully to a smaller extent than it used to. If you consider that in 1939, until even the 60s, there was a bounty in Greece for monk seals and dolphins. So if one killed a seal or a dolphin, they got a monetary reward by the government. So it was a government-sanctioned bounty. It's very hard to blame individuals for intentionally killing animals. In fact, I have spoken with older fishermen who will very happily admit that yes, of course they have killed monk seals in the past, but because society is changing and we know more and more about the importance of species and biodiversity in general, the same fishermen will say that today they would never do this because they know what the importance and what the rarity of this animal is. And of course, years ago, when human life barely had any value, it's hard to blame fishermen for disregarding the life of an animal. Thankfully, as I said, there's a decreasing trend in intentional killing. Unfortunately, it still occurs today. And a big part of our work is trying to work around this competition between fishers and monk seals. So the best way to do this is would be to provide compensation for the losses by marine mammals to fishermen, which would keep everyone happy. Unfortunately, this is not as easy to do as it sounds. As I said, the situation is changing. Here we can see a fisherman in Alonissos being very friendly with a monk seal. This monk seal had the behavior of being very comfortable and friendly towards humans, as is the case with most seals that display this behavior. He paid for it with his life, unfortunately, because it makes him an easier target. And it only needs one person to kill a seal. But here we see a very touching situation with an old fisherman in Alonissos hugging Thodoris the seal and being very hopeful for a future of cooperation between the two instead of competition. A second massive threat for the monk seal, which is especially pronounced in young animals, is that of accidental entanglement in fishing gear. So, of course, this is also a product of the interaction with coastal fishing. We have found that it is 46% of deaths for young animals, so subadult and juvenile animals that I described earlier. The problem is that when these animals become independent, they try to find food, they very quickly realize that a stationary net is a buffet to be taken advantage of. However, because of their lack of experience, if they get caught, they panic, they start twisting, they get themselves entangled and they eventually drown, unless of course they are lucky to be able to stay above the water and breathe. And if they are even luckier, the fisherman himself or someone else will find the animal entangled and will cut the net. Here we can see a photograph of a spearfisher that found a very lucky young male and cut the net, and this animal actually survived. And we've had many reports by fishermen themselves who find the net, find the seal entangled. They realize that the net is destroyed anyway, so might as well disentangle the seal, and the seal survives. That is, of course, not the case in most cases. In most cases, the animal will drown. This is, of course, damaging both to seals and fishermen. Overfishing. It causes a reduction in fish stocks, inability to find food, and it exacerbates the previous threats by making it necessary for the monk seal to approach fishing vessels increasingly. Honestly, overfishing is not such a big problem for the monk seal because the population is not large enough to it's at a state where it can cover its energetic needs. And frankly, because it's easier to approach fishing vessels, seals would do it anyway. Of course, the combination of these threats has led the seals to a life of crime. Here we can see a seal that has taken up weapons. Actually, this is a real photo. It's not of a Mediterranean monk seal. It's of a Hawaiian monk seal that actually found a knife and someone and was playing with it. And someone got a video of it. And I found it funny, of course. Who wouldn't? Another threat of the monk seal, which is becoming increasingly important, is that of degradation of habitats, mainly because of coastal development and tourism. So caves are becoming an increasingly rare commodity for seals. High quality marine caves with a beach inside where seals can breed are becoming increasingly rare. And as the population of seals increases, available caves decrease because each cave has a specific carrying capacity. So let's say a cave, when I see a cave, I can say, okay, this has the potential for 3 mothers to have their pups, or this cave has the potential for 1 mother to have its pup. So the females will actually compete for the high quality caves because space is limited and each female wants space for her own pup. At the same time, uncontrolled coastal development has taken over most of our coastline and has made even more caves unavailable. So it causes a disturbance that discourages animals from using certain very high quality marine caves to breed because of the existence of human populations, human settlements in the area. It's the same again with tourism, mainly kayaking and diving tourism, but also boating tourism in general. And it's we are seeing a trend now where visitations to caves are increasingly advertised both by kayaking tourism operators and by diving tourism operators, which of course is not ideal for the species. Far from it, in fact, because we have found that certain very high quality caves are not being used by seals because of tourism. Climate change also plays a role in this, as it can change the beach in the cave. So more extreme weather events can wash out the beach and decrease the area of the beach. And also more extreme climate events also lead to an increased pup loss, because the mother has to leave the pup alone in the cave, if there is a storm while the mother is away, the pup might get drawn out by the waves, drawn out of the cave by the waves, thrust around, and lost. And the mother will come back to an empty cave, and she will give up on the pup most of the time. So seals, they are increasingly made to use less suitable caves, which, as I said, leads to an increased loss of pups. Pollution, okay, it contributes to the degradation of habitats, contributes to reduction of fish stocks. It also causes a weakening of the immune system. In the Mediterranean, especially marine mammals have very high concentration of pollutants in their tissue, muscle, blubber. And it compromises the immune system and also causes problems with fertility, reduced fertility. And also you have natural events such as pandemics. For marine mammals, a specific virus, much like we have coronavirus now, they have morbillivirus. In 1997, in the Western Saharan population of Cabo Blanco, around 30% of the population died off because of a pandemic event of morbillivirus. Now the population has recuperated, but there was a massive loss then. Since then, there have been smaller outbreaks of this virus, but most of the population remains immune. So, these have been the threats the monk seal faces today. I would like to talk to you a bit about also mom and what we do regarding the conservation of this species. So mom was founded in 1988 and has been working with research, rescue and rehabilitation, protection and management, public awareness, and environmental education. So a big part of our research today has to do with mapping the coastline of Greece for these marine caves that monk seals use. Now we have completed around 90% of the Greek coastline, which when considering the length of this coastline and complexity of this coastline is quite an achievement, I like to think. So in 90% of Greece's coastline, we know exactly where monk seals breed and rest. We monitor these caves that we found so we monitor the populations locally, both using our rescue and information network, but more importantly now using cameras that we place in these caves that we identify. So before the breeding season, every year we will go to certain caves, we will place cameras. And after the breeding season, we will collect these cameras. We can identify individuals by the scars that they have on their back for the females and from the white patch on their belly for males, which helps us to estimate the total population. We can know the number of births that occurred within each cave every breeding season. So we have a very good idea of how the population is distributed, what is being born where, which animals use which areas. This information adds up, and we have an increasingly better image of the seal in Greece. A big part of our work, of course, centers around seal and fisheries interactions, both with specific area closures or changes in fishing areas that we discuss with fishermen, making different management plans for fishing, depending on the seal activity locally, this can be managed. We do, of course, necropsies on animals that die, which help us not only know about the cause of death, to know about which threat has more weight and what to deal with, but also it allows us to know more and more about the physiology of the animals, to gather samples for analysis, toxicological analysis, virus analysis, virological analysis, bacteriological analysis, etc. And now we are also doing a lot of research on the genetics of the monk seal. In fact, there has been a very interesting finding that within the Greek monk seal population, there are certain differences genetically, or mainly centered around the Aegean and Ionian. So the Aegean population, there's the North Aegean population and the South Aegean population that share some genetics. So there is genetic exchange between the two. However, the Ionian population is more genetically poor, and there is very little genetic exchange between the Ionian and Aegean populations, which has started to cause problems apparently in the Ionian population. Very recently, we had a couple of weeks ago, we had a pup from the Ionian that we brought into our rehabilitation center. Unfortunately, it didn't make it, and the necropsy showed that it had internal dysplasias, arterial dysplasias and other dysplasias, which most likely have occurred because of genetic depression and genetic inbreeding. So this is something very interesting. Here you can see our scientific director, Alexandros Karamalidis, outside the cave, a male in a cave. Okay, you can see our website where you can report a sighting, a monk seal that has been released from rehabilitation and has a GPS tracker on it, a monk seal embryo, genetic analysis. Again, our scientific director, Alexandros Karamalidis, he is massive, he's Australian size, I like to say. This is the process of placing cameras in caves, exploring caves and placing cameras in caves. Here you can see us doing the safe method, which is using a kayak to go in a cave. Most of the time that is not the case. Most of the time we go swimming because, you know, adrenaline, I don't know. Most caves are not, I kid of course, because most caves are not easy to visit by kayak. The entrance might be too narrow, too low, etc. So it's much easier to go swimming. Placing cameras, we drill in the rock and place a camera in a protective shell. These cameras are motion activated or set in a time lapse. And here you can see the product of the photos of the cameras. Here you can see three females sleeping together. Seals like to touch each other. They like to have contact. In the other photo, you can see a female here with her pup. Rescue and rehabilitation, this is a big part of our work. On-site rescue also has to do with adult animals. So adult animals, we only do what we can on-site 99% of the time, because it's very hard to transfer an adult animal. It might require a course of antibiotics. If it's required, we might try and fence it so that it can take the whole course. But adult animals, we only rehabilitate on site, whereas newborn pups is mainly what we work with in our rehabilitation station. A lot of the time, as I said, the pup might get separated from the mother. The mother will unfortunately forget about it. We'll decide that I'll make another one next year. This can happen mainly due to stormy weather that draws the pup out of the cave while the mother is away, and these pups require immediate care and rehabilitation. So we this is an adult animal receiving some eye cream and an antibiotic shot. So the newborns, we will take them to our rehabilitation center in Athens, It used to be in Alonissos for 25 years, but it moved to Athens recently because the building in Alonissos got old and we have a new building in Athens now. And here you can see the whole all the stages that the animal will go through. Here we have two seals that we had together. Unfortunately, the smaller one, these are the same age, but the smaller one has been alone for a longer time and has lost a lot of weight. Unfortunately, he did not make it. His name was Nicolas, and he was trying to feed, he was trying to nurse from the other one, Ionas, hoping it was its mother. It was not. Here you see a small seal, Bill, with his neonatal black fur and white patch. Here you can see Bill shedding his fur, molting. And here you can see Bill with his juvenile pelage. The feeding process, in the beginning, you have to feed them with a tube because they are unable to swallow their food, and it's safer to avoid any liquid going into the into the lungs. Slowly you start moving from liquid food to solid food and start teaching them how to eat fish. And hopefully eventually they start eating on their own from the pool. Of course, all the medical necessary medical exams are done. Here you can see a very polite patient when they are young. Then older, when blood is when we need to take blood, it requires four of us to hold them. They are very strong, and for a 3 or 4 month old animal being 60 kilos is quite impressive. And of course, the grand finale, the release. Bill here with very happy to be back. Back in nature, back in the wild. And here we see the last two animals that we released, Lena and Nicole. Lena and Nicole, again, when they arrived, same age, but Nicole, the one on the platform, is much thinner because she just arrived in the rehabilitation center, whereas Lena has been in the rehabilitation center for some time. And then the best of friends, after 4 months of rehabilitation, ready to be released. Protection and management, of course, is a big part of our work. The establishment of protected areas, the biggest of which, of course, is the National Marine Park of Alonissos in northern Sporades. Karpathos and Saria is another regional protected area that has been established for the protection of the monk seal. The Natura 2000 network also helps with the protection of the monk seal, and a lot of Natura 2000 areas have been added to this network exactly because of our research on the monk seal. And of course, we are MOM is the author of the National Protection Strategy for the Monk Seal, awareness and sensitization campaigns. First of all, of course, we have our information center in Alonissos. We used to have information centers in other islands also, in Karpathos, in Kimolos. However, because of the economic crisis, that was no longer viable. And awareness raising throughout the country. Frankly, the biggest the factor that has played the biggest role in the recuperation of the monk seal population and the fact that now its population is increasing is public awareness and a general shift in society and our attitude towards not only seals, but wildlife and nature in general. Environmental education, school programs that we visit visit schools. We have a certain package that we can send to schools for teachers to use. Website such as Thalassopedia. And which brings me finally to the latest news about the species, which is, first of all, that because of the increasing trend in the population, there has been a dispersal to areas that the animal was considered completely absent. So Cyprus is the biggest example of this, where very recently, in the past 3, 4 years, 5 years, we have had a reestablishment of a breeding population in Cyprus, where for the past 3 decades, the animal had completely disappeared, which is great news. We are working very closely with the forestry department of the environment ministry in Cyprus and certain scientists there to protect this new population and to deal with all new developments. There has been recent sightings of young monk seals in Albania. And we are currently doing a project with Albania, Montenegro and Croatia to prepare the ground for the re-establishment of the monk seal there. However, along with the population increase, come certain problems. The biggest of which is the reduced space for the animal. As I said, marine caves are becoming increasingly rare because of the population increase. Seals are using lower quality caves, leading to an increased pup loss. Seals are coming into more contact with humans, especially young males that are being thrown out of traditionally seal territory. They come into contact with humans, and they, because our attitude has also changed towards seals and they are not immediately shot on sight, they might become habituated to humans, as we can see here, a photo of a seal on a seabed in Samos Island. We have been seeing this throughout Greece occurring in, more and more often. Unfortunately, the fate of these animals is to be killed because 99% of society might be very friendly towards animals, but as I said, it only requires one bad apple, let's say, to do the deed. So unfortunately, we are not ready for this kind of cohabitation, apparently. So this will need to be managed more and more in the future. So what is very interesting is that for the first time, there has been a recorded birth in an open beach. And in fact, not only once, but three times, a female, the same female in the island of Crete, has given birth for the past 3 years consecutively in an open beach, which is something that is, it has been recorded for the first time in since the animal has started being scientifically studied, which of course is a product of reduced space for the animal, but we are seeing a shift here in behavior that will be very interesting to observe and very hard to manage in the future. So that is all. I'm sorry if I rushed through this. Thank you for listening. And I'm here for any questions you might have.
Thank you, Kimon, for that fascinating, exhilarating sort of presentation. Some really nice photos there. And there have been quite a few questions that have come in from our audience, and we'll just commence with those. A question from Vicky Lamboropoulou, one of our teachers of the Greek community. What's been the action of the European Union on this matter, and the Greek government itself? What's its position, or what's its role in assisting the protection of the monk seal?
Okay, so from the point of view of from the European part, of course, Europe has certain targets for environmental protection, nature protection in its countries. And in order to achieve these targets, there is a certain budget allocated to projects working on natural protection, biodiversity protection, etc. So a big what do you call it? Well, budget, I guess, allocated is through the LIFE projects that fund large-scale, long-term projects for the protection of biodiversity. So, of course, there's a certain level of support. Truth be told, money is finite, and the problems are almost infinite, it would seem. So everyone working in any on any problem really would always like more money allocated to their problem, which would be nice, but of course this cannot always be the case. You know what I mean? You understand what I'm saying this correctly?
Yes.
So for example, when you have so many problems regarding health in Europe,
there are finite resources for every problem. So
finite resources for every problem. Yes, it would be awesome to have infinite resources to allocate to the monk seal, but that is not always the case. And of course, this brings me to the Greek government part of things, which of course, with economic crisis and all the problems being faced by the Greek government and all the holes that need to be plugged. It's very possible that the monk seal and nature conservation is not a particular priority in this. Of course, there are certain funds allocated to natural protection in Greece by the Greek state. They're not massive. I'm not complaining because, of course, there's other problems to be taken care of.
Okay. Vicky's also got another question, but I'm going to rephrase or hijack her question. Can you say a few things about the study of marine biology at Greece at university level? I mean, where can you do it? Let's say a major in marine biology. How many students annually are we talking about? If I can just follow up on that, are there any is there any research done for any other endangered species in Greece? Or
Because I did not study in Greece, I studied in the UK, I'm not very sure about the numbers. You can do marine sciences in the University of Mytilene, and you can do, I'm not sure about the name of the course in the University of Thessalia, aquatic, can't remember. So I'm sorry, I really can't answer these questions with any sort of certainty. However, when it comes to marine protection in Greece, there are many NGOs that work either with specific species or with marine protection in general in an area. Another endangered species that is, of course, specifically targeted by many organizations is the loggerhead turtle, Caretta caretta, which has shown a very, very big increase in its population. And is today only considered vulnerable, I think, down from endangered or even critically endangered decades ago when this work started.
Okay, thank you for those comments. You should come to Australia to come and do your PhD in the Great Barrier Reef.
I really should.
While it's still around and hasn't been decimated by climate change, but anyway, let's not get off topic. A question from Vasilis Samis. Should Greece start declaring national marine parks in cave-heavy areas crucial to the survival of the seal?
Or yes.
Suppose they have competing interests there. And
yes, it should. There's because of the marine caves, they do not yet enjoy the necessary protection that they should, really, considering the importance that they have for such a rare and emblematic species for Greece. So yes, it should, but the whole process is very slow, and of course, as you said, competing interests. It's not as straightforward as it should or could be.
Thank you. Just got another question from our sponsor, John Kotsiaris. Are there any particular recommended changes or improvements to the law in Greece that you should, could help significantly better protect the seals in our habitat?
Yes. Regulating approaching or entering marine caves would be one of the first to consider. And of course, the whole situation with compensation for fishermen would be another. Okay. It would make all the difference for the species.
Okay. Thank you for those comments. Another question. Given the lack of genetic diversity in the Ionian Sea seal population, is there a plan to relocate animals from the Aegean to the Ionian?
It is something that we are considering now. Not relocation of animals per se, but for example, when we have a pup that we rehabilitate that comes from the Aegean, we might release it in the Ionian to slowly start increasing the genetic diversity there.
Okay. A question from Christos Fifis. What other kinds of seals are found in Greece?
No other kind of seal is found in Greece.
Okay.
There is a sea lion, a California sea lion found in Greece, but it's in a Corfu, in a pen, performing. Actually, this is a funny story. Years ago, someone sent mom a photograph of a dead California sea lion. And they said, I found this in the Ionian. And mom said, no, that is not possible. It's something else. And then they realized that it was an animal that was in a pen that had escaped.
Okay. Just another question. The last few years with COVID, having fewer tourists, has that helped the seal population at all?
It's hard to tell with certainty because we have seen an increase in pup production the last 2 years. It could be related, or it could simply be unrelated and coincidental because of the increasing population anyway. You expect to see an increase in pup production. So last year we had a record of 75 recorded pups, which has been the most we have ever recorded. It's hard to say. We did see more animals approaching, being more comfortable approaching human settlements, which again is not necessarily a good thing. As I said, animals approaching human settlements and becoming habituated to humans. Sometimes they are fed and they will start approaching humans to be fed. It does not end up well for them usually.
Okay. What intrigued me was the seal population off the Western Sahara coast. So if I can ask a question around that.
Please.
The Western Sahara for quite a few decades now has been illegally annexed by Morocco. The Sahrawi people that live there, in their culture, do they mention the seal at all? Do they have any connection with the seal?
Actually, I don't know. I don't know.
Okay. All right, just a
comment. The seal population in the Western Sahara, it is located in a very specific area that has three large caves that all 300 animals use. And they range some kilometers away from that, but mostly they stay in that one specific area.
Okay, and one final question. Is it possible to breed the seals in labs in an artificial environment?
Possible, yes. Necessary, not yet. And it won't be, because it's because the population is increasing, now. It never became necessary to start a captive breeding program.
Okay. Thank you for that. I think we might bring our proceedings to a close. Kimon, it was a very sort of enjoyable presentation. We definitely sort of learned a lot, and I think we'll be keeping our eye out for any developments on the Mediterranean seal going forward. And many of our students on our Greek school campuses often use this as a project as well. So yeah, it was a quite fascinating seminar to have for us. Yeah.
Thank you very much for inviting me. It was a pleasure.
Okay. Good evening. Good night, everyone. And we hope to see you back at some future event.